you cannot hear that song and remain seated. The Bible says, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you are visited him. You have made him a little lower than the angels. Who are we that is mindful of us? Let's just raise up those hands and just worship him. It's God. God alone. He's not dependent on anyone. He lives in eternity. There is no time in him. There is no time in God. He exists by himself.
You are the king.
We exalt you, our God. No one has authority over him. It's not under anyone's control. It's not under anyone's influence. He reigns and rules. He does as he pleases. He's never called by them. He made them for his pleasure. He's exalted forever. He's a magnificent God. The God that cannot be reasoned. The God that cannot be restrained. Father, in heaven we exalt you. We magnify your name, Jehovah. Oh, we worship you. The one whose strength never fails. You are never weak, you are never feeble. You do not sleep, you do not slumber. We exalt your name, we worship you. We thank you for life. We thank you for making us in your image. We thank you for giving us the privilege to call you Father. We thank you for being our God. We worship you, we worship you, we worship you. We come to honor you this power. We come to remind ourselves of your word. And so Lord, the word of God. Lord, I pray that in this hour, the word will become flesh again.
Amen.
That the word will become flesh in the hearts of every one of us. I pray, Father, in this hour, that every wall in the hearts of every one of us that will not permit the entrance of your wall. Father, I pray that by thunder break down the wall. In the name of Jesus, I pray that your irresistible power shall be made manifest in this hour. That no one will be able to gainsay the word that shall be uttered. That no mindset will be able to resist this word. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way. Jesus, you said, without me, it can do nothing. Lord, without you, I can do nothing. But I pray, Lord, for the free course of your word. Free expression of the word. You want to say there is no word of God that is devoid of power. So I pray that every word of this power shall be accompanied with the power of God for divine accuracy and precision. And it shall not return to you void. At the end of it, O Lord, you alone will be glorified. Thank you, precious Father. In Jesus' wonderful name, we pray. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, church.
Hallelujah.
Good afternoon. You are welcome to the house of God this afternoon. In Jesus' name, can you please turn your Bible to the book of Matthew chapter 6? Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to read from verse 9 to 13. Matthew 6. 9 to 13. Jesus speaking said, "In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Praise the Lord!
Hallelujah.
I believe every one of us, at one time or the other, we have recited this, we have prayed it. Now, the title of this message is "My Father in Heaven."
Hallelujah!
My Father in Heaven. Praise God. And the key words in that message really is that it talks about two things. It talks about my Father, and it talks about where my Father is. My Father is in heaven. It's not talking about my heavenly Father who died and had gone, and I hope he will be in heaven. But it's talking about my Father who is in heaven, who has been living in heaven, who has been in heaven from eternity, and will remain in eternity. Praise God. Now, I believe it's the graciousness of God. God is super gracious, that he makes us to be able to refer to him as Father. I mean, it's such a wonderful privilege. No wonder the Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 verse 1, it says, "What manner of love has the Father bestowed upon us, that we are called the children of God?" So it's a wonderful privilege to be called the child of God. If you permit me, there are so many things that many of us are looking for. But just imagine yourself, all of a sudden, you are given the title to be a royal child, a royal son or daughter to the Queen of England. Just try to picture that. Your life will change, your situation will change, your mindset will change. But we are not daughters and sons of the Queen of England. We are daughters and sons of God, who is in heaven. The one that the Queen of England submits to.
Hallelujah.
The one that Donald Trump submits to.
Hallelujah.
The one who was the breath of mine in his hands. If he said, "In a moment it's over," it is over. If someone dies, if he said, "No, I will give the authority the permission to live," it will be. If he says to do something, no one can say, "No, you can't." That is the privilege we have. And I say, what depth of love? You know that song says, what height of love? What depth of love that we are placed? Now, before we are called sons and daughters, who do we know as the Son of God? Jesus. Jesus is regarded as the only begotten Son of the Father. And now ponder over that. We, as it were, we are given the same privilege to be called the sons and the daughters of God. Now, the one that had that privilege, the Bible says, he knew no sin. The Bible says concerning Jesus, he said, "He that knew no sin was made sin." He had never sinned. The one who is glorious is the one regarded as his son. But now, look at you, look at me. Look at where we are coming from. Look at what we have made, how we have messed up our lives. And look at what we do even on a daily basis. Look at our capacity to sin, our capacity to lie, our capacity to do evil. And yet, we are blessed with that graciousness to be called the sons and the daughters of God. It is a wonderful privilege. I pray that the Lord will preserve us in this privilege in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, every privilege has to be used well. Every privilege has to be used well. And I remember very well the parable of our Lord Jesus Christ, the parable of the royal banquet. Now, in that parable, Jesus Christ spoke about a man, a very important man, a wealthy man, who made a banquet. Everything was ready. Anyone invited to that anyone that has the privilege to be invited to that banquet should feel highly honored. And the Bible talks about of a man who came to that banquet. Now, all of a sudden, it was discovered that the man was not properly dressed for that occasion. That was a man that was given such a great privilege, but he did not value the privilege. So he came to the banquet, he dressed anyhow. He dressed shabbily. He abused the privilege. He abused the wonderful privilege that he was given. And many of us, we abuse the privilege of the sonship and daughtership, if there's anything like that. We abuse the privilege and of the sonship and daughtership of God. If God has called us sons and daughters, we must not live as bastards. We must not act otherwise. It's a privilege. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you picture God a moment and us in a relationship with Him, God is not a consultant. But most of us treat God as a consultant. Who is a consultant? You need professional help, you go to the consultant. You know, you raise the issue. And the man gives solution to the problem, you walk away. That's a consultant. That's a consultant-client relationship. That's how many of us treat God. There's a problem, of course, you come to the consultant. He's a holy consultant. He gives solutions to the problems, we walk away. We wait for another problem to arise to come to His presence. God is not a consultant. God is not a mercenary. That's how many of us use Him. Who is a mercenary? There's a battle. There's a war. You engage in mercenary. Please come and help me. And you know, engage in this battle. The victory is won. The mercenary is paid, and you pass ways. When there's a battle again, you call the attention of the mercenary. God is not a mercenary. Can you say to yourself, God is not a mercenary? God is not a consultant. God is much more than that. So who is God to you and I? God is our Father. Amen. And I believe if we comprehend the significance of God being our Father, our attitude and response to Him will change. If we reflect very well and comprehend what it means that God is my Father, our attitude and response to God or to anything about God will completely change. If you look at the healthy relationship of father-son, when you look at a child, because that's where you can really model the picture of father-son relationship. When children grow up, you know, we live on our butts. Imagine when a child is growing up, you know, when he or she has started to become aware of pains, you know, and can talk. Now, the father is everything to a child. The father doesn't know who a doctor is. All he knows is that, Dad, I have a headache. Now, or if the child is aware of a doctor, he or she will not call the attention of his father. So, it is because of the limitation of man that the father who has nothing, who can't do anything, will say, okay, there's paracetamol. Or the father will rely on a third-party help, third-party support, which is the help of a doctor. But as far as the child is concerned, all the child knows is the father. So, Dad, I have headache. Is that? Now, when he or she has a need, the child doesn't know where money comes from. The child does not know how the father or the mother gets money. All he or she knows is that, Mom, I need this. Now, it is the helplessness of the healthy father and mother that either say, okay, wait a minute, I don't have this now. Or let me work some hours, let me do this, I'll get money for you. Now, our Father in heaven is not like that. He is the answer to all needs. He does not need any third-party assistance. He does not need any third-party help. You are in need of help. He is the help. You are in need of healing. He is the healing. You are in need of provision. He is the provision. But wait a minute. When the child is growing up in the house, I said the father is everything to a child. The father is beyond the need of the child. Do you get that, please? Mm-hmm. The father is beyond the need of the child. Because There are many times in the house you are doing your things, they are doing their whole days. So what is the significance? What the church thrives on is the ambience, the fellowship, the environment of peace and comfort that the Father provides for him or her. Not just in the time of need. His joy comes in that environment that I'm within the comfort, I'm within the security of my Father. Not necessarily in the hour of need. And that is what our Heavenly Father gives us. But in our own case, we treat God as a mercenary. We treat him as a consultant. We disregard, ignore, or we don't sufficiently value this environment. And that's what takes us away from his presence. That's what keeps us away from him. Because we don't see God beyond the need that we have. We see God only in terms of what we need. But there is more to God for us. There is more to God in our lives than our needs. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, in a father-son relationship, you know, there are these obligations. A father's duty is to love, while a son's or a daughter's duty is to obey and serve. Do you get that, please? Do you get that, church?
Yes.
What's a father's duty, please? To love. What's a son or a daughter's duty? To obey and serve. Which is why in Malachi chapter 3, 17, God speaking says, I will make them my dwell. He said, in that day, I will make them my dwell, and they shall be mine. I will spear them as a man speareth his own son that serves him. A child's duty is to obey and serve him. You and I have God's duty, you know, and I want you to reflect, please. In what way am I obeying and serving him? Now, God fulfills his duty. His duty is to love and to show affection. Our duty to him is to obey him and serve him. Praise God. In the love of God, there is tremendous care. He cares for us so much. And that's why we have not perished. That's why we do things that qualify for us to perish right away. But his mercy spares us. If you read the account of David in the book of 2 Samuel chapter 18 verse 5, the story of David and Absalom, I believe it typifies exactly the love of God. Let's look at it, please. 2 Samuel 18 verse 5. We are looking at the love of God, the commitment of God. Now, before that, let me give you the background. Absalom, the king's beloved son, had rebelled against the dad. He didn't just rebel, he rebelled to the extent that he wanted to take the kingship, he wanted to usurp the authority of his dad. He actually deposed his father. Now, when the time came, it looked as if they are finding they are going to arrest him. This is the word of David. The king commanded Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man, even with Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave the captain's charge concerning him. That typifies the love of God for us. In spite of the rebellion of Absalom, David was saying, please deal gently with him. In spite of your rebellion and my rebellion, God is always saying, give him another chance. Don't let him perish. No, don't let my heart of judgment fall on him immediately. But the question is, are you and I, don't we take that love for granted? The love of the Father, he fulfills his own duty. Praise God. Now, when we say our Father in heaven, you know, I say Father in heaven. Now, it also establishes where our Father is. In Isaiah chapter 66, verse 1, God says, he said, the heaven is my throne, the heart is my footstool. So God lives in heaven, and where a man lives is relevant. It's we can attack the authority of a man to where he lives. Where he lives to an extent also determines his strength. It determines his power. If a man is living, if a man, for example, is put under that chair, the man is incapacitated. There is nothing the man can do. Even if he loves his child so well, and his child is there and anything is coming, there's nothing he can do because he's restrained. God is not restrained. The heaven is his throne. The earth is his footstool. It means everything on the earth is under the authority of God, of our Father. Everything on the earth, principalities, powers, situations, circumstances, they are under the authority of God. And God our Father, because of his love for us, he wants all those things to be subdued under our feet. Praise God. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, and he shows himself mighty on behalf of them whose hearts are battle with you. God wants to show himself mighty on our behalf because he is our Father who never fails in his duty. But the question is, what kind of child am I? What kind of child are you? I want to speak with us very briefly on four kinds of sons or daughters, but I will only talk extensively on two. There are four kinds of sons and daughters. If I use the word son, please permit me, it's not sexist. It's just for the purpose of this presentation, if you like. There is a rebellious son. There is a prodigal son. I'm sure we know the prodigal son. We know the story of the prodigal son. But there's also a rebellious son. Now there's also a distant son. And there is a faithful and abiding son. I will speak only of two. I will speak of the distant son and the faithful and abiding son. You and I, through the grace of God, should picture where we are and trust God for a turnaround. I pray that will be a turnaround for us today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Who is a distant son? Now, a distant son is a son who maintains fellowship with his father from afar, from a distance. His intimacy with the father is occasional. Not because there's a physical restriction. Not because the father wants it that way, but because he wants it that way. That's why he's distant from the father. It is not the choice of the father. It is his own choice. He is aloof, is detached. He's, of course, because he's distant, he's not available for the father's assignments. He's not in the house. It is the child that's in the house that the child can say, please go and do this for me, please go to the garden. But the distant son is not available. He's detached. He maintains a status that does not reflect the status of his father. The distant son wants to do things his own way. He knows his father is wise, is glorious, but he just wants to find out things by himself. He knows his father has a great dynasty, but the distant son wants to build his own dynasty with his own strength, with his own wisdom, with his own minds. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Now, because the son is distant, he first recognizes that before his father becomes very old, as become of age, he is full of experience, full of wisdom. And the man has gotten accustomed to secrets of life. And there are secrets of life. But because a distant son is distant, he doesn't know the secrets of the father. He doesn't know the way of the father. The father wants to reveal a lot of secrets to the distant son. But the man is distant, or the woman is distant. He does not want to know. And so, he doesn't have that privilege of understanding the secrets of God. The Bible says the secrets of the Lord is with them that fear him. God has secrets. God has a way. God knows the way of danger. He knows the way of life. He knows the way of prosperity. He understands what it means to persevere. But the distant son is so distant. He does not have the fellowship, the relationship to be able to learn the secrets of God. What is God saying to this category of sonship? God is speaking James chapter 4, verse 8. To everyone, anyone among us, who is convinced within him or her that indeed are the distant from God. God is saying, draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. That's what God is saying this morning to everyone that is distant from him. He's also speaking John 15, verse 5b. The Father is speaking John 15, verse 5b. He says, without me, you can do nothing. You may think you are wise, you may think you are clever, we may think we are strong, we may think we have connection, but the Father is saying this hour, we are too distant if we are. Without me, we can do nothing. And so we should draw near if we are in this category by seeing the intimacy with the Father as all that matters. Because if we have intimacy with the Father, He will reveal His secrets to us. He will reveal His way to us.
Yeah. Yeah.
We will be in the ambience of His comfort, of His security. Even when there is storm, we will have the calmness of the Spirit to know that He is in control. Why? Because of the intimacy of His fellowship. We cannot afford to be distant from Him. Praise the Lord. And quickly, I speak to us about the next category. The abiding and faithful son. In John 8:35, Jesus said, a slave does not abide in the house forever. A slave. So the contrast. He said, but a son abides forever. So if we are truly sons and daughters, Jesus is saying, the son abides in the house. So the faithful and abiding son is a reliable son. Because his reliable is within the Father's reach. The Father can count on him. He is always in his Father's presence. God is calling us if we are be distant. Come into his presence. Come and dwell in his presence. When the Father calls the faithful and abiding son, because he understands the love of his Father, he understands that his calling is not to destroy. The scolding is not to cast away. The scolding is to build. The scolding is to empower. How many of us have been scolded and we take it the wrong way? The faithful and abiding son understands when God, the Father, disciplines him. Amen. He's always eager to learn. He's handy to use the strength and wisdom of the Father to benefit himself. The strength of God is there. But we need to tap from the strength to benefit ourselves. The wisdom of God is there. We need to tap from that wisdom to benefit ourselves. Praise God. Abiding and faithful sons are not deceived by what the world is saying. They are not. They patiently remain in the presence of their Father. They cannot trade the love, the affection of their Father for anything. They know that one moment away from the presence of the Father, it's so risky, it's so dangerous. It does not mean that they will die right away, but they will lose something of great significance that they will find difficult to recover from. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Psalm 31, verse 15. The faithful sons know that their times are in the hands of the Father. They know that it's the one that changes times and seasons. And so they wait patiently in his presence because their times are in his hands. They know he will make all things beautiful in his time. That is how a faithful and abiding son conducts himself. Their times are in the hands of the Father. They know, they are sure, he will make all things beautiful in his time. So, brethren, my question to you and I this morning is, what kind of son are you? What kind of daughter are you? God is calling you. God is calling me. If you have a distance, God is saying, draw near. And if you believe you are faithful, God is saying, I even want you to be faithful the more. I want you to be faithful the more. I want to reveal myself more to you. If you are faithful, for example, by saying our Father in heaven, it reminds us of the residence of our Father. It also reminds us the kind of citizenship that we have. Philippians 3:20 says, it says, our citizenship is of heaven. So, a faith in abiding soul recognizes that my citizenship is of heaven. I cannot afford to live anyhow. It's cherishing the time of reunion with the Father. So, he keeps himself holy because of the mindset that his citizenship is in heaven. I thank you for coming to church this morning, brethren. Believe me, I thank you. I know because you are in church this morning, it's something that brought you. So the love of God is in our hearts. Something brought us into his presence. It could be to solve a problem, but at least there is something that made us to long for him. It is that thing that brought us to church. Praise God. But the revelation this morning is that God has so much in stock for us. So much. Why should we be satisfied with a touch and go relationship? Many of us are in a touch and go relationship with God. It is touch, go, touch, go, touch, go, touch, go. God said to him, come and abide. There is something in the house. There is something in the love of God. There is something in the affection of God that if we sign up to it, we will continue to enjoy it. It is new every day. Praise God. Let's rise. Let's rise. Pray. Let's pray. Every one of us have a decision to make.